Welcome everybody. You guys are an awesome crowd. Everyone kind of settled in here very well. Awesome. So I'll introduce myself. My name is Mario Tapia, President of MobileMonday. Been doing this type of meetup since 1999, so I've done quite a few. But a couple of important announcements for tonight. Restrooms are in the lobby, so you can find your way out past badging and security, and you'll find restrooms out there. We'll have, help yourselves with food and drinks if you guys are thirsty. If you guys want to have a conversation, just take it out to the lobby here where the food is at, where the badging was. You guys can have a conversation there. Yes, the pictures, video recording are all welcomed. And let your phones ring, part of our industry. We're all making money somehow. So, not like the movies. Tonight, it's the year in review. So, wow, 2015 went by so fast. And 2016 is now here. And so, traditionally we do this in December, and it's an all VC panel, and we kind of look at what happened in 2015 in terms of investments, industry, acquisitions. And so, tonight we have a stellar audience. Samsung, 500 startups, PEJMAN Ventures, and also BMWi Ventures. For people who are tweeting, Mobile Monday and also Pound Mobile First are hashtags for tonight. So I'll do a brief welcome and the overview, and then Brendan will do an overview of the Global Innovation Center. This is where you are at. And then we'll jump into panel discussion. Panel should be wrapped up by 8 o'clock. And then we'll do like an 8 to 9 networking opportunity. If you guys want to hang out and network, panelists will probably hang out as well to meet with them. And then we'll have lights out by 9 p.m. I curate events here in Silicon Valley, New York, and also LA. So and overall, I think we're about 30,000 folks. Thank you. Actually the Valley is 20,000. So we have 20,000. We have like 8,000 in New York and about 6,000 in LA. Globally, there's in Tel Aviv, they're having an event, just like tonight, Berlin, London, Taipei, Singapore. So it's a pretty active community. So when you're traveling, just mention that you're, you look around in the different cities, and if it's on a Monday night, you might find people just like you in a meeting like this. We're about a third. Okay, who actually writes code here? I'm curious to see. Because you guys notice I ask these questions when you guys register. This is development sales, outwardly focused. Product and marketing. Who here is working for a startup? How many people here are founders? Are there founders here? All right, cool. Okay, that's your media. Is anybody from media here? Bloggers, media, stuff. All right. And then there's a few VC behind me, I think. Designers. I always like these. I call them the unicorns. See, they're like two people. Yeah, designers. Yeah. It's always like only two people, like one guy. Yeah. So this is kind of who's here new to MobileMonday, first time, and it's always like half. Yeah. Wow. So this is kind of like our monthly topic. We do a technical session called a lab. So for people who write code, this is more of a deep dive into an SDK API for a certain company, and then we do these roundtable dinners, which are more invite only. And you'll see probably on our newsletter how many people get my spammy newsletter. Yeah. Wow. Okay, so you can always apply to the dinners there, and it depends on the sponsor for the dinner. They're always looking for founders of certain type of startups, so there's IoT, cybersecurity, AI, big data, cloud, and stuff like that. And then we'll look at your background, and then we invite you to those things. But that's kind of an idea of kind of our engagements that we do here in the Valley, and then. We do have a lot of corporate sponsors. This is kind of like people who contribute to us. If you guys are interested in also finding out more, like how do I get to more events, check us out at mobilemonday.us. Also, Meetup. How many people are on Meetup group? How many people are on like our newsletter that aren't on MeetUp?
No.
Wow, it's awesome. Okay. Twitter is MomoSV. Facebook, we have a good group on Facebook. We have, I think, 500 likes. Yes. Kind of sad. You can like us on Facebook, and you won't get a lot from us. We'll probably just get the announcements for the meetings. And then on YouTube, how many have seen our YouTube site? So the last, thanks to John Lynn, who's on the camera, I think we have the last five, six years documented there. So we have I think over 70. Thanks. Yeah, we had it for John. So we have a lot of good content. I mean, from beacons to cybersecurity, we have a lot of good content there that you can take a look at. And I'd also like to give a round of applause to our sponsors for tonight, Samsung, and also IBM is our global platform sponsor for the year. So give these guys a round of applause. So we're done with the overview. I'd like to introduce Brendan Kim. He has some words and some thoughts to mention.
Hi, my name is Brendan Kim. I'm Managing Director of Strategic Investments for the Global Innovation Center. I want to welcome Mobile Monday, all of you, to the Samsung Mountain View campus. Just a few words on Global Innovation Center. Global Innovation Center was created about 3.5 years ago, purpose-built to work with startups to help bring software and services innovation into Samsung. I think we're recognized leaders in lots of areas with hardware in particular, but I think one of the things that we know is that we can learn from people outside of Samsung, and one of the areas that we can use a lot of learning is around software and services innovation, and that kind of software and services innovation is being done by people like you here in Silicon Valley. So we're very pleased to have you here. The GIC is formed of four teams. There's an early stage investments team, which I lead. There's also an accelerator that works with very young startups, like two founders and an idea. We have an acquisitions team as well. And we also have a partnerships team that works with perhaps more established, larger startups. So we want to welcome any startup in whatever the life cycle is. So if you're young, we'll adopt you. If you need investments, we'll invest in you. If you want to get acquired and look for an exit, we might acquire you. And if you just want to partner, and you don't want all these other things, we can partner with you as well. So again, welcome to Samsung and welcome to GIC. Thank you.
So let's start with Edith and go down the line and have everyone introduce themselves. Name, where you work, and then we'll get the introductions done. Sound good? Mm-hmm.
Sound good. Okay. It does work. Hello. Hi, my name is Edith Young. I'm with 500 Startups. For those of you who, just in case you don't know 500 Startup, we are early stage accelerator, also a seed investment firm. Been around for about 5 years, since 2010, have done about 1,400 investments so far. And half of the investment is done right now. We actually do 125,000 for 5% of the company, and usually about 1,000 company, and we accept 30. For the 30 companies who spend time with us, either in San Francisco and or in Mountain View, usually we basically bombard you with mentors and daily classes and investors, and we end a 4-month program with a demo day. I actually focus on not accelerator deals, but instead early stage investment, which means that I look at a lot of mobile related, talk to a lot of entrepreneurs and startups, so they invest outside of the accelerator. I usually do anywhere between 50,000 to 200,000 early stage.
Hi, Brendan Kim from Samsung GIC. Just a little bit about our early stage program. So we're investors in seed, Series A and Series B, investing about $250 to about $3 million at a time. We're pretty active investors. We've been around for about 3.5 years, and we've had about 37 investments to date, so about a kind of a one-a-month pace. It's hard to sustain that, so we'll probably do a little bit less this year, I'm hoping. We invest in a wide spectrum of technologies. We are, we are part of Samsung, so we care about the strategic impact that startups bring to Samsung, but we are financially driven. We just recognize that what we have to bring value to startups in order for us to create value for entrepreneurs, for our co-investors, and for ourselves, we know that we have to take a strategic angle on things because that's the value we bring to the table. We bring the power of the Samsung platform to the startups that we invest in. And so in that way, we're strategic, but we are driven primarily by financial returns. If you need to get a hold of anybody on our team, the best way to do it is hellogic@samsung.com. So pretty easy, I think. Hellogic.
Hi, my name is Mar Hershenson. I'm a founding partner at PEJMAN Mar Ventures. We're an early stage venture fund. We're actually pretty young, about 2.5 years old. We've done about 35 investments, and we primarily do what we call internally pre-seed and seed. We've done some A's. We have some amazing companies in the portfolio, like DoorDash or Branch Metrics, or several pretty large companies. That we seeded when there were two people and an idea, and that's where we get involved. And we again also sort of try to surround our founders with our community to get them very quickly from idea or T0 to the next step.
Cool. I'm Mark Plachon, and I have the great advantage of not being an employee of BMW, but I'm here. I'm the Silicon Valley guy for BMW Ventures, and by not being an employee, I can be a real provocateur internally, and that's kind of my job, is to push on that. We've been around for about 5 or 6 years. We're mostly investing in things that are related to mobility services, so parking and charging and traffic and mapping and sort of the new mobility, if you like. We go all the way from $100,000 seed on an early, very early stage idea to, in the venture group, a $5 or $10 million participation. Of course, BMW separately paid their 1/3 of $3 billion for buying here in the last few months. So our interests in this space are pretty wide. Anyway, we'll have fun today.
Awesome. Thanks, Mark. So let's kick it off on what kind of investments do you do, and are there any specific verticals? So we're kind of interested in, I'd like to see most of you guys answer this, what verticals are you interested in investing? And I know some of you also mentioned at what stage, but kind of reiterate the stage and maybe elaborate on the amount. You're more like, hey, I want to do 100K, half a million. So let's, curious to see what you guys do.
So I guess our sweet spot is to do Series A, but we like to do seed and get involved early as well. We'll typically do $500,000 in a seed round, and then a couple $1 million, or help lead or co-lead a Series A at that point. We're interested in sort of, if you want to use a filter for what we really care about, is there's kind of an evolutionary arc from electrification, connected, autonomous, and shared. And that mantra, I think, if we're looking at something that helps a legacy automaker, and how many people here drive a BMW, right? Cool. If we're going to be what we want to be in the future, we got to think about what does it look like to be electrified, autonomous, connected, and shared. And that mantra is how we make a decision on whether something's strategically relevant or not. And we're not trying to help those companies become part of BMW. BMW makes 2% of the cars in the world. Obviously, we sort of fight above our weight class, but we... So we're trying to influence things, but we're not going to own parking garages, we're not going to run mapping systems, we're going to build, try to influence things that everybody uses, but that we can then be the winner at.
Does that mean if I don't drive a BMW, I'm disqualified?
You can have a Mini Cooper. Or a Rolls Royce. No, of course. You know, it's actually important for people to understand when, and I think this is for Brandon as well, you know, when a corporate is in your boardroom, we're not there to help the parent company. We're there to help you become a success. And if the best deal is making a deal with Mercedes or Audi, that's fine. Be a success.
All right, so we are actually pretty broad focused, and we invest pretty much in everything that we think get a good return. We have companies that do consumer mobile apps all the way to companies in robotics and companies in genomics. We have a company doing cancer detection on a blood test. So it's all over. In terms of our most SaaS and consumer companies, obviously everything has to be mobile. It's hard to have a company and not have some sort of mobile strategy and some data or machine learning based strategy. It's almost like a default of whatever you do. So, it's no longer an option. We invest in basically three stages at the very, four stages, but really three at the early stage. One is what we call dorm. So dorm might be two people and just an idea, and we look for something that has some advantage. So it might be like they have some technology advantage, or it might be they have some domain expertise advantage, they have something. And those are small checks, under 50K. We only do a handful of those. We're not an accelerator, so we don't have tens of companies a year. It's very few of them. The next stage is a pre-seed. And a pre-seed, typically you have some prototypes, or you're past the idea and we can touch or feel something. You may not necessarily have a customer or a check or even a ton of users, right? But at least there's something we can touch. And in that case, those rounds are typically anywhere under 500K. We call those pre-seed internally, we call them soil, because it comes before seed. There's no more nomenclature. The next stage is a proper seed, and in a seed, you write checks anywhere from 500K to a million. And one of the things I want to point out, and I think maybe we'll talk about this today, but what was needed 2 years ago to get a seed versus what is needed today to get a seed is actually quite different. And people have much higher expectations for, any entrepreneur walking in and getting a seed. The median seed has gone up in terms of valuation, in terms of total money raised, but those people have a lot more to show when they raise that seed. So you may hear about, raising a million and a half, two and a half, but it does take, the expectation is you've already shown repeated usage, repeated sales, et cetera, at that point. Anyways, and I don't know if I'm missing any questions.
We are early stage investors, so by our standards, early stage for us means seed, A, and B. I'd say about half our deals have been in A, half our deals have been in seed, half the other half. Half our deals have been in A, a quarter has been in C, and a quarter have been in Series B. In terms of areas, I mean, Samsung, we're so active in so many different markets. It's harder for us to say no to something than it is to say yes, we're interested. But in general, I think we try to do two things. One is we try to make sure that there's a glide path to some kind of collaboration or partnership. So long as we see a glide path to that, it doesn't have to be immediate. It can be a year out or even 2 years out or further out, but as long as we see a glide path towards the ability for our team to add value and change the course of the company, we're interested. Having said that, I think the things that we're interested in right now are IoT, particularly industrial IoT or enterprise IoT is really interesting for us. Cybersecurity continues to be a real big area for us. AR and VR has been a big area for us this past year in 2015, and I think we're going to continue to see a lot of emphasis around AR and VR this next year. Enterprise is also an area that we're very interested in. And then I think the last area perhaps is sort of AI as a horizontal technology. There's lots of different applications that we can find around that. And then the last thing I'll say is about just our philosophy of investing. Mark mentioned this a little bit in terms of adding value at the board and things like that. But the main thing for us is that we want to be option enhancing to entrepreneurs, never option limiting. So it's okay for you to have Apple devices in the room. I see a bunch already. we sell components to those things, so that's okay. But we want to make sure that any company that takes an investment from us are free to work with competitors, have exits to competitors. We've had a number of exits. I think we had 7 exits in our portfolio of 37, and one was to Microsoft, another was to Apple. So the main thing for us is we want to be good partners. If we're not good partners, then you shouldn't work with us and you should go find somebody else, even if we are investors, right? And it's not always the case that a partnership or a collaboration that we see in the beginning works out, right? And I think about the strategic returns in the same way that I look at financial returns. You know, we're going to have a couple of 10Xers, and a lot of them aren't going to work out. And that's going to be the same is going to be true on the strategic side. But what we want to do is make sure you have every opportunity to work with us. And that's what we mean by being option enhancing and never option limiting.
Instead of talking about what the three sort of unicorn for 500s are Twilio, GrabTaxi.
It doesn't work.
Say that again.
Microphone.
Maybe other mic.
Other, does it work? Maybe. Twilio. GrabTaxi and also Credit Karma. So historically, we have done really well in SaaS marketplaces, and any sort of like more consumer focus. If you come to us and say, hey, you know, we're working on enterprise, usually even for accelerator deals, we don't invest in things that haven't at least, if you have not launched, we probably won't invest. So we don't do the soil,
relaunch.
That's thing. Yeah, so unless there's somebody who, I actually did recently invest in the former CTO of Mozilla, who's working on IoT, very interesting thing. So that was definitely in the soil of pre-launch stage, but that's a more exception. But usually if you, you know, come and apply, because we have so many applicants these days, if let's say if you're working on a mobile app, you don't have at least 100 or 200,000 install, there's really not enough data for us to look at. So usually I will probably tell you, hey, launch it first, and let's revisit if you have some numbers to look at. If you're working on anything that's more B2B, you have to sell and go through a certain sales process and cycle. Then we would like to see at least 2 or 3, you know, conversation and pilot. So you can basically show that you have some interest of a real enterprise customer. So that's sort of the, of course, I mean, it really depends, again, what you're working on. Just now, actually, right outside, there was a couple entrepreneurs pitching me. They do a really, really interesting thing. But the first thing is, if you're talking about building a photo community, then the first thing I'm going to ask you is, why would I use you and not Instagram? If you're improving things that is just a little bit better, then I guess as a very consumer, like mobile focus, I haven't actually invested in any app-related startup for the last 6 months. It's been just been so expensive, it's so hard. I'm really, really big on VR. I just done my first investment of VR, which I guess we can talk about it later. It's an amazing guy, I will tell you all about it, but I'm very bullish on that. Sort of related to AI, I have a very strong belief in messaging platform. And I think it's just a matter of time that Facebook will launch payment. In fact, they already did more for peer-to-peer. And they hire a whole bunch of people from PayPal, and I know they're going to build that up. And I think there's a whole bunch of things that they can learn from Kakao or WeChat on how they actually operate with commerce and doing all kind of online and offline way of business models.
And you've seen this in China. We've seen this in China, right?
And I have a whole article written around this. Yeah. And literally, if you're doing anything related to that, I will be very happy to chat with you.
So, segue to this question. What you look, you know, kind of what you do and verticals. What do you look for in the company to invest in? So now maybe we've found the vertical or bucket that you're interested in, but is it the product? Is it the team? Is it traction? What is it that gets your attention to invest in the company, decision-wise?
I think the way that you present your product and the way you talk about the traction is a reflection of how good you are. So it is, at the end of the day, it's all about you. And I think most of the investors, and I'd love to hear your thoughts as well, most of the investors see thousands and thousands of pitches. So pretty much we all sort of ask the same.
How many a year? 1,000, 1,500 a year that you look at?
Easily, if not more. Yeah. And so most of the time we pretty much ask you the same questions. And after a few times, you know, talking to some other investor you probably don't want money from, we all practice. And you get to a point that you sort of already know what investor will ask. And by the way, pretty much all the 500 startups demo day pitch, all the videos are online. It's completely free. If you haven't watched it, you should, because this is pretty much what we would usually ask. So if within the first minute or so, you're not really saying some of the just minimal certain numbers, you launch or not, you know, how long, within how long you actually be, it's all about you. Because I actually done about 22 investments in the last 14 months since we launched a mobile fund. And some of the folks have no problem raising follow-on round because they're just so good at it. And some of them still having a hard time expressing, you know, this is a goal, we need it within certain times. And those are the ones usually having a harder time doing follow-on round. And for me particularly, because I invest in early stage, it's super important for me to think about, all right, 6 months or 18 months from now, would this person be able to have the ability to raise Series A? And that's what's going through my head.
Let's go to Mar, because Mar is in the soil investing.
Super early.
Yeah. So what's the criteria, what are the characteristics? And it's in reference to product, team, traction.
At margin as well, but absolutely, I mean, I have to agree with Edith, it's all about the founder and the team, especially when there is no product, there's no customer, the only thing we can go by is the founder, right? And we are looking, you know, obviously we want somebody that has a little bit of an edge at some form, even at the dorm stage. Do they know something somebody else doesn't know, because say you've worked in an industry for a very long time, you come from research and has a technology that is hard to replicate. We're looking for some edge, but also the most important is the person. You have to be, we're looking for people that have a compass, so they know where they're going. I hate when people say we're raising a million because we want to last 18 months. They don't really know where they're going. So I want people to tell me, I'm gonna get there, it's gonna take me this much, and I have this margin, and I know once I get to this point, I'll be worth more back, whatever, 2x, 5x, whatever it is. That's a good operator, and I know that person has a plan, and things don't work out, they'll adjust, but I think being a good captain of the ship is really important. You need to be determined, you have to be the last person to leave. So there's a lot of analogies we're looking for, that sort of character at the very beginning, when there's nothing, right? The more the company has a lot been alive, the more stuff you have out, the more money, the more product, the more customers, we're gonna do more diligence on that. You still do diligence on the person. The person is super important. But, we're gonna look at, what are your retentions, what are your long-term value of the customer, how much does it cost you to acquire somebody? A lot of people will just buy their way into a round by spending a lot of money on ads, for example, and I think smart people will figure it out. I mean, there's a lot of questions that, depends on your industry, the farther along you have. But the most important is yourself, and, I give your advice, what Edith said, good communication is super critical. So if you're not a good communicator, go get public speaking. If you can't explain your startup in 15 seconds, go try to figure that out, practice in front of the mirror, that's the way to get better. It's just very basic, but very important.
So you do later stage as well. So I'm curious to see the differences. What do the do the characteristics change as you go later stage? Or
I think it does a bit, but we've sort of concluded we've not had great success with solo founders. If there's no team, if there's just one guy or woman, just one person, we have not had a good record. Now, some of you may be the superstar, and it's fine to have one person. But we have found that we're looking for people who have built a small team. And if there's two or three, that's the ideal size founder group. Four is great. More than that, you probably don't have founders. You're starting to build your team. But one, it's lonely to be a CEO. There's nobody to talk to when you're alone. And as much as we'd like to be your confidant, we're not going to be. I think if you're trying to do this and you're not having the success you want raising money, go find those other two key people that fill the missing skills you don't have. And if you have all the skills, you're in the wrong place. The other thing, and it applies to our very early stage companies, a lot of companies start with a bridge loan. And so they have debt. They don't have shareholders, they have debt holders. Now, even if you're using a safe, it's gonna be equity in the future, one that converts. In the meantime, a lot of founders and startup teams think, hey, I don't have any shareholders, so I don't need to have board meetings. That is wrong. Don't do that. Make a plan, have board meetings, get whoever you're gonna be, board members are gonna be, your advisors, your whoever, get them in, have board meetings, lay out your plan. Frankly, when you're early, have those board meetings every 2 weeks or every month. Don't make a big preparation for them. Just whatever your Monday plan is for your team, share it with the advisors, because you're probably working on the wrong stuff.
I'll just add just one thing that I look for. I think the best investments that I've made have had people who failed. And I look for resiliency. You know, resiliency is this new word, this buzzword last year about how you raise your kids and be resilient, things like that. But I think that's really important. And you learn a lot from failure. And you learn a lot about a person when they go through really tough times. So when times are good and everything's going right, then everything's great. But it's really when things don't go well that you really start to see what your investors are like, what your co-founders are like, what your employees are like. That's really a time of testing, right? And so I think if you've had great success in everything you've done, that's super. And I don't encourage you to try to be a failure, but I think failure is not a bad thing. And so taking risks and failing teaches you a lot. And I learn a lot about a person when I talk about when they failed and how they've recovered, what they've gone through. Doing reference checks around people who failed is really important.
Cool.
Well,
so let's talk about IoT and virtual reality. Two hot topics in the valley. A lot of attention in the industry, and I just wanted to see, obviously Edith, we know that VR is big interest to you, but for the rest of the panel, where does VR and also kind of IoT have snuck up on us in the last 3 years? It's hardware sexy again, and especially for the valley, right? Because hardware used to be done here, and if you find, how many people are embedded engineers? Right, there's a handful. Do you have gray hair? It's been that long. So it's been like 20 years since we've done hardware in the Valley. And so, finding an embedded engineer is going to be pretty hard to find, as many of you guys know. So let's I'd like to hear your thoughts. You know, these are two big, growing, very fast-growing industries. A lot of hype, right? We haven't seen the traction in the industry yet. but curious to see what your thoughts are. Brendan,
so
put the spotlight on you.
I'm holding the mic, I guess. So we're obviously big believers in VR, right? So we have our Galaxy VR device. It is the most affordable way to have a really good VR experience. You can obviously go cardboard, but I don't think you try cardboard, try Gear VR. Yeah. Gear VR, I think, is it's really opened my eyes. And it's, VR is one of those things where it's hard to explain. You really have to try it to believe it. And that's, I think, one of the issues with VR.
Hey, how many people have done VR headset? Tried it on? Wow. Early adopters, get out of here. Okay, how many people have the Gear VR at home or have tried it?
What VR have you guys tried?
Okay, cardboard? Yeah. Is that the one? Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, that'll probably be the first one. Okay.
I think there's definitely a market for cardboard, definitely a market for Gear VR, definitely a market for Rift, and for Vive, and for, I think Sony's going to come up with their Morpheus. I think they're calling it PlayStation VR now. And there's HoloLens too coming out from Microsoft, right? So there's a ton of activity in this space. I think if you try some of those experiences, you may not be a complete believer, but you can see where it's headed, right? And I think that's where the promise is. I think one of the interesting things when I was first pushing VR as an investment area, the pushback that I got from people at HQ and the rest of Samsung. Is this like 3D TV? Is this just like 3D TV? And I think it's really different this time around because for VR, and VR's been around for a long time. It's a decade ago there was talk about VR and how it's going to revolutionize everything. So this is not new. But I think for the first time. I think there's a groundswell of developers and startups, and you didn't have that with 3D TV. It was not a ground up kind of effort. And we certainly didn't have content developers coming to us and saying, "Hey, we want to develop. You know, this is really interesting." We were more for 3D TV going out to content developers, "Please, will you make something so we can sell out more of our 3D TVs?" So I feel like this time around it's different. Having said that, it's still very early. Right? The number of Rift devices out there and the number of even Gear VR devices out there, it's gonna be very small this year. Even in 2016, it's gonna be very small. But I think what we saw in 2015 is this groundswell. I think 2016 hopefully continues that groundswell. And we get to see some real interesting experiences out there that give you an indication of where things are headed. We're big believers in VR. We've made a bunch of investments in VR space.
What's gonna be critical there? Is it gonna be the content? Is the hardware is there? And is just like on a mobile ecosystem, without the app stores, without the content, you can't create it. So what are your thoughts on?
I think two things. So one thing I mentioned before is that VR is something that you can explain, you have to try it. So I think that's a big impediment, is that if you don't have a good VR experience to try, then people don't understand. A lot of us in the room have tried it, but you talk about the rest of America and have they actually put on a device like that. It just looks weird. You put this thing on your head, right? So it's very experiential. You can't like demo it very well. And then second thing is content. You have to have good content that's not gonna make you sick. That's appropriate for the device that you're using, right? So that's a big deal.
So true.
More directional content, because in 2010, I was advising a couple of VR software developers that came up with points of interest. They were out of London. They came up with the New York and the London channel. They come up with apps for VR for mobile, and they found that, well, the mobile work was too distracting. Wind up killing yourself walking down the street paying attention to Spider-Man. We even approached Marvel. Marvel loved VR apps. They were thinking Spider-Man crawling all over. But that kind of just all died down because it wasn't realistic. Now with the new technology, what kind of content is going to be attractive to Samsung?
So we're experimenting with all different kinds of content. So we're doing everything from games to our partnership with Oculus, all the way to simple 360 panoramic videos. So just, you know, doing this kind of thing. So, to be honest, I don't know. I'm not sure that anybody's really figured it out. So is it gaming? Is it education? Is it like tourism kind of stuff? Like, you know, you put yourself in a different place kind of thing. Is it more around animation than live action? There's still lots of things that need to get figured out around that. So to be honest, I don't really know exactly what that content is like. But again, I think that content has to be very appropriate to the device that you're aiming it for. So a Oculus Rift can do things that you can't simply do on a Gear VR device. It'll make you sick, right? So you have to make sure that the content you're developing is appropriate to the equipment that you're making it for. And then the equipment's just gonna get better and better too. The devices are getting better and better too.
We'll do one more question.
Yeah, I would just say, I think broadly VR, augmented reality, is probably gonna be the thing that takes off, because the use case for virtual reality, I think, is much narrower, whereas within augmented reality, I think there's a much broader use case where I can see adding content overlays in the real world could really help people.
That's a pretty prescient comment.
The question's about augmented reality, and that's probably more of a wide mass adoption of technology as opposed to virtual reality.
Normally when you have a cool new technology and you throw it in an auto company, you don't expect to see it for at least 7 years. It's the honest truth. AR, I think BMW saw it 2.5 or 3 years ago, seriously, and thought it was doable. And this year we already showed goggles that work with the Mini Cooper. So when you're parking, you can look over there, and there's the curb. You see right through the car.
Awesome.
And that's pretty awesome. You can tell there's a fire hydrant right there, whatever. But you also can see on the heads-up display and the navigation stuff, you can start putting all kinds of information on that. And that starts to be something people can understand get right away, and you know, to have the big boys starting to roll that out means it's doable, it's real, it's cheap, it works, it's cool.
I mean, exactly, when you're driving on the freeway in fog, you can have radar that will see the cars in the fog, can't see visually, which is an overlay.
So, Mark, do you have any thoughts on, are you doing any investments in VR or IoT?
We have not invested ourselves. I mean, BMW hasn't, and my other venture funds have not done VR yet. We've done some AR application things. We've done some video morphing stuff, some cool things. But no, we're
real
little slow on that.
How about you, Mark?
Yeah, we've looked at a bunch of stuff. We haven't done any investments on VR yet, but we've looked at a bunch of stuff. Infrastructure, there's content for gaming, a lot of enterprise applications of VR, where, you know, I think they might be more niche, but there's definitely a clear application where people will put on those goggles and, you know, use it. We haven't done it. I don't know if you want us to talk about IoT now or later.
You mentioned IoT, Erin.
Okay. We have done some IoT, and we've just shifted to doing industrial IoT, and we've done a couple of investments in that space, and those are, immediately revenue-generating companies because they solve very specific problems that, you know, big companies have. They want to measure stuff that is hardly accessible, that they need to send a person, and you can use all these connected devices to do that's very efficient. I think there's a ton of opportunity in industrial IoT. Anybody here wants to do hard work? So,
comments on IoT?
A couple months ago, I invested in the first IoT company called Penrose. They actually going to Sundance.
Yeah.
Amazing. It's magical. so I can say. And it's public, so you guys can definitely try that. But there's a couple other things that I think Brandon was saying earlier that I found interesting is VR journalism. And there's a handful of studios that have done some amazing work. But along with that, because it's taking real life, and you have to stitch, and that process takes a little bit of time, so there's a whole bunch of also equipment that now, most of them are fairly expensive if it's professional. So I know there's a handful of sort of drone plus, you know, camera also in various different price points. So I can see that also keep coming down, but for now it's super expensive. So there could be opportunities there. If you talk to some of the professionals, they will tell you all about it. I'm not professional enough, but there's definitely things that's gonna come out. And I thought another thing that could be interesting is live streaming of VR. It's definitely sort of in the future and can't support it now.
Like sports would be.
There's a couple, like Next VR, we didn't invest in it, but they also raised like $4 or $5 million. And medical use case, it's just also interesting, although that experience is not that great. I definitely throw up by looking at it. but when you talk about journalism, of sports, of live events, these sort of things, you pretty much most of the entrepreneurs I met so far come from that industry, and partner is somebody else. So if you're thinking about that, ideally you should already understand that industry first, and so now this is another medium. But on IoT, frankly, I am not a hardware expert. And if anybody, having said that, we within 500 Startup, we have some expert in hardware. And I want to say we've done about 20 sort of smart home related investments. But pretty much all of that have to go to Shenzhen to create this. So if you don't have any sort of manufacturing and you're creating actual tangible things, at least in my books, and it's going to take you another 2 years to figure this out. I'm not that into it, but on the software side, so on the hardware side, usually I probably will call, you know, Brandon and Mark up and say, hey, what do you think if it's hardware related? But on the software side, I think, you know, as you mentioned, security is interesting. I am not expert on enterprise and industrial, so I probably knock on your door also. But on the communication layer, security, I think is interesting on the IT side.
So questions on, what were the biggest newsworthy events in mobile for you in 2015? Brendan, you have the mic.
Yeah. I gotta keep this mic away from me. For me, you know, I think the most interesting for me was sort of industry related in just a number of corporate venture deals that have happened and how many corporate deals are happening and how corporates are really getting into the venture game. So. I think there was over $7 billion invested by corporates in 2015. 20% of every deal had a corporate investor. I think it equated to something like, I forget whether it was 13 or 15%. These are NVCA data points. But the amount of corporate investing was really interesting. So that poses an interesting question, I think, for co-investors and for entrepreneurs. And because corporates are becoming much more active, especially the early stages, and they're really getting down to the early stages. And the question becomes, so when is it appropriate for a startup to think about taking corporate money? What are the upsides and downsides of taking corporate money? I think traditionally, you know, prior to coming to Samsung 3 years ago, I was at a mainstream financial fund. And when a portfolio company would come to us and say, hey, I'm thinking about raising a strategic round, we would, all kinds of yellow flags would come up and we'd say, you know, why are you taking money from a strategic? You know, is it dumb money? You know, are they gonna pay a lot of money for the shares? And you know, things like that, right? And so I think those kind of questions about like when to take strategic money, why to take strategic money, what value does a strategic offer you versus a financial investor offer you? I think those questions are much more relevant to early stage startups now than they were just a few years ago. I will say that as an answer to some of those questions, I think there are good reasons to take strategic money and there are some not so good reasons to take strategic money. But I think it's just like any other investor, you should be asking the question of why am I taking money from this individual or this institution or this corporate? Because everybody has a different value to add, and you should be taking money from people who are going to add value at the appropriate time, right? So I think that's, that was an interesting thing for us is just, you know, when I got started at Samsung 3 years ago, I didn't think that we would have as many corporates involved in the game as we do now. So that was a big news to me. And then, of course, the other crazy thing is that we have 239 unicorns. That's just crazy.
And are you, do you have any others?
No, but I think, no.
You have some coming.
You know, some of those unicorns, yeah, you know what, I'll take that off.
Okay, so maybe I have two answers. I think one of the, for the audience, is I think a lot of you are founders. I think one of the bad news in 2015 is that I think in Q4, a lot of the people realized that the bubble popped, and we're going to see it coming in 2016, I think.
Don't jinx it.
It's already here. And if you're a founder, you have to know. It's your job to know that it's going to take you longer to raise funding and that you have to take care of your cash. So it's just times are different than 2 years ago.
But it's interesting that it's a cycle. I mean,
it's a cycle. It's a cycle. And you have
having
to
been in the race for almost
this is the third
years now,
time it has happened in my life, and you know, it's just a cycle, and you, the people that adapt to the cycle do better, to survive. And if you don't adapt, you will die. That's kind of the way it is. It's just the way it is. Anyways, unicorns, some of them will not exist for sure. I should say we have one unicorn, so we're very happy about that, I guess. Okay, so that's on the bad side. I think on the good side, I think one of the biggest things in 2015 was Messenger, Facebook Messenger. I think, you know, obviously it's been happening in Asia. A lot of these messengers are very different from the way we text. But I do think that, you know, the way we would, there will be a new interface in, by which we communicate to a lot of services, apps, and even business services that don't even have an app. And it will be via your text interface using natural language processing, APIs, etc. So I'm very excited about that. We've done a few investments in that space, and I think the, you know, it's, I don't know if you guys used Peach. I don't know if anybody here has used Peach. It's a recent app, and if not, I encourage you to use it because it has, I'm not sure if how big it will be, but it has a lot of this new interface that I think will happen in the next, you know, whatever, couple of years. So it has all these keywords where you makes your card more efficient when you're interactive with your phone. So it's super exciting.
Cool. So let's see. The when I think about IoT, you know, what is the T? In some case, we're talking about the car as like the biggest T in your life. So we're looking at a lot of communication and connectivity things between cars, between cars and the grid, between cars and infrastructure, between cars and the cloud, what needs to be local, what in fact can tolerate the latency of going over the long haul. And so at one level, we're sort of thinking about the connected car. As one of our IoTs. But then when you think about sort of the future of retail and things like that, you know, we invested in this Polish company, Estimote, that's putting beacons everywhere. Now they've put them all over the Target stores and the
Apple
and
stuff. Was that you, or did you?
It was me. It wasn't BMW. It was my other fund. So I work for BMW a couple days a week and do their deals, but I also, when they see everything first, and if they turn it down because they don't think it fits what they do, then I can help those guys get funded somewhere else. So I bring it to wherever. So I get to do both. But, you know, the right now, I mean, you were saying that there's a lot of other hardware-related stuff. I am super excited about what's going on in 3D printing.
Can you see the 3D printed car?
Yeah.
The 3D printed car.
Yeah.
But the 3D printed components, 3D printed cars, 3D printed drones, 3D printing allows you to make things of variable thickness so you can optimize weight reduction. You know, we were looking at some...
Have you seen the military stuff where you can... metal part,
you know, a part that would weigh 5 pounds, you can make for less than a pound. When you can take 80% of the weight out and still have the same structural strength, it's a huge, big deal.
Yeah. And I think also fabricating on demand. So imagine your aircraft carrier and I need 200, you know, swarm drones. I can print them on demand. I mean, that was some of the things I would see.
And I am super excited about 3D printing. On the other hand, people sometimes get confused between what is a part, what is the finished part, and what is a component. Because you can print a component, but if it then has to be have bearings pressed into it and machining done and other parts, you know, think about a water pump, right? It's not one thing. It's a thing, it's a whole assembly of things. So, you know, to expect that you can just put a printer at UPS and they'll print it and deliver it to you. A lot of stuff doesn't work. I mean, you can't even make a pot that way. It's kind of handled and that's insulated in a pot that has to get hot. Don't assume everything can be printed without any extra stuff.
So, Mark, I have a question for you on, so what impacted you in 2015? What impacted the automotive industry?
Well, that's easy.
The big news, right?
Hello, Uber. I mean, this is, you know, CES has turned into the car electronics show. 20 automakers plus some people who think they're automakers were there. And there were, you know, but really, Uber is Uber, Lyft, and that whole sharing economy really is changing the way people behave. I mean, we were doing a little survey. Since I loaded Uber and Lyft on my phone, I haven't used Hertz and I haven't used a taxi.
Yeah.
I don't know how many people have the same thing, but
right.
You know, the number of times you've rented a car dropped way down. Hertz and Avis, and these guys have to think about that. And if Uber is moving towards, you know, with Carnegie Mellon, what they're doing, you know, we're headed to a world that's really, really different. Really, really safer, really, really better, but completely disrupting, you know, a multi-trillion dollar part of our economy. So that has been a huge big deal. And it's all part of this, you know, you go electric and then you go connected and then you go autonomous and then you go shared and, you know, people's behavior, we always say, don't invest in something that requires behavioral change unless that behavioral change is compelling, because then people will switch up, boom, and that's what's happening.
Big yellow cab went bankrupt on the first of
January. Oh, yeah.
And that's going to happen around the world.
You guys walked
here. Yeah, the big guys are terrified of being dependent on Google for maps, so... They bought their own maps.
So, like 2015, and also sort of related to what Mark just said, I think sort of the Uber economy, I absolutely believe that this year, I mean, they already started doing this, open up their API and let other people to tap into sort of their delivery network. And if you're saying, at least to me, since I'm early stage, you're going to be the Uber for whatever, I will basically just shake my head and say, don't do it. But on a different note, on that, you know, sort of related to transportation, what actually shocked me in 2015 is sort of the rise of the Asian sort of investors and also the Asian version of everything. And the fact that, you know, Didi Kwadi is invested in Lyft and Grab Taxi and Ola Cab and to compete with Uber, I think it's just so fascinating. So
to me, but all the combined still raised less than Uber alone. And the fact that they're now worth $75 billion is just unbelievable to me. So that's sort of on the transportation. And Mara said earlier with messaging, I think that I'm just so excited about what could happen on top of that. And I think last but not least is just, you know, we touched on that already. If you look at Box, which went public, and the last final round that they raised is actually valued less than the valuation that they got on IPO. So I think the party is definitely a little bit over, and all the investors will really look closely at your numbers if you have already launched, and it's not going to be as easy.
But those are self-inflicted wounds. You know, these are great companies that are still doing better and better. And the fact that one investor decided to throw money at them, or that the bankers kind of got all pumped up and sold people a bill of goods, the companies are great companies doing a good job. And I think we need to separate kind of the underlying good companies from the weirdness of bad pricing models.
I mean, do you watch that Silicon Valley show on HBO? And the guy said, "You mean I could have said no? Why did I say no? With all this money?" It's like one of those effects, right? It's like, "I'll just write me a $500 million check. Yeah, I'll take it." And you kind of paint yourself into a corner, right? Let's skip over to international. So I have a couple of questions that I like to understand. You know, definitely lots of countries pumping in money to be like Silicon Valley. A lot of tech hubs, and so I'd like to understand, you know, from your point of view, where are you looking for investments? Are you looking at other regions? You know, Israel got an awesome, it's a hot area for tech. India as well. I think happened in 2015. I started to see a lot more investments, and also globally leading companies coming out of India, and also China. Right, you know, China is exploding, and there's. And you know, how many guys went to the Connections? It was Cheetah Mobile's conference, right? And so that didn't happen 2 years ago. You know, now we're starting to see Asia engaging us. I like to see what your thoughts are. Are you investing globally, and are you actively, you know, going into the regions, the markets to find startups, or are they coming here?
Really quick, I'm really big on China. And I've been going there almost every month. And I would like to do some investment there. But I haven't done any because it's so expensive. At least 5 to 10x more expensive than what I see here. And have, anyway, the stock market, I am, hopefully everything will calm down a little bit and I will actually make some investment there.
Is that because of momentum investing like we saw before our last bubble that there?
There is another level of bubble going on in China for the last few months, and which also explains why so many Chinese investors in town, because they think Silicon Valley is really cheap. They're still continuing to be
good. Okay, raise your hands. How many people here are founder of a startup that moved here from abroad? They came from out of country. Wow. Okay. That's it. Raise the seat, Rod. Don't be shy. Come on. Ice is not here tonight.
But really quickly, 500 startups pretty much have in all major continents, including India, Israel, Russia, Brazil, London. We have people actually in all these different major hubs that we want to invest internationally. So definitely a big thing is to go global.
So the major criteria for GIC is, you know, we want to be able to manage the investments appropriately and provide the appropriate kind of value. So most of our investments tend to be local. Having said that, innovation is global. We recognize that. It's happening everywhere. So we mentioned messaging platforms in Asia in particular, like WeChat. I mean, they're just killing it in terms of innovation and what they're able to do on that platform. Israel, in terms of security, just outrageous kind of talent in Israel. So we're looking at those other markets. We have made investments that are located overseas and have a lot of engineers overseas. You know, I think previously it was about investing in overseas teams because they were cheaper. And I think for us, at least, the calculus has changed. And it's not about being cheaper. It's about really good talent and finding really good talent there.
We're a small firm, so we are mostly here in the Valley. We do have one investment that we did a couple of years ago in Korea and China. Beauty Box, they sell beauty products for Korea, and it's been growing like crazy. That's what I mean, it's another different size when you go out of here. We are about to do two new investments, one in India and another one in China, that we rely on having local investors. So unless there's somebody there that we know that is leading the deal, we wouldn't do it because there's so many details that are different from here. And you know, sometimes these companies want US money because they want contacts here, they want to talk to people here, they want the experience of people here. But we wouldn't do it unless there is somebody there that we respect.
Let's see, as far as China, I'm doing only later stage stuff in China. You know, three guys and a dog in China is really scary. No. No, but we are, you know, once we've got a company that's built up real technology, and then they're raising money to build a factory in China, and they do a woofie, and, you know, we own 49% of it or whatever, and we've really got amazing talent, amazing money, a great building, and really going to town. That's, for us, that's when the leverage of having China and China money and China talent really come in, and it's been enormously helpful. Otherwise, you know, literally, you know, today I had an Argentinian group in, yesterday I had an Israeli group in. We've got French groups, we've got the Polish, you know, is Eskimo. Our German friends, most of our team's in Munich, they've never done a deal in Germany. We keep looking in Berlin, but we haven't found anything. So Europe really has a problem, and they're writing about it and talking about it, and they don't know how to solve it, but they just don't have. The old Europe doesn't have the culture. We've done some deals in London, but it's really hard to find stuff. So the good thing is most of the, you can sit in the Valley and a lot of great stuff comes through. I mean, the consulates bring 10 or 15 Israeli companies in, and then the French embassy brings 10 or 15 vetted companies in. And if you're on the venture to tourism track, they show up at my door.
with the topless bus. And it pulls up, hey, that's Mark Classen. No,
that's an idea of a business.
So I'm curious. All right, so most of you I know have your email. But how many people here need money for their startup? How many people are raising money for their venture? All right, so how do I go about meeting you? How do I go about engaging VCs? I don't know you, so do I email you, which maybe goes into the ether and black hole? I do social media, I follow you, tweet, you know. What is, as a founder, trying to get your attention, what works? I've heard a lot of creepy things too, but what does work for you to get your attention? Or what's the front door? How can entrepreneurs engage with you? What's kind of what are the best tactics to use?
Well, in our case, I think you know, the best thing would be to get an introduction via somebody that we know. You know, 10 years ago there was no LinkedIn. It's really hard to find how to actually get to somebody. But I think today, if you're a founder, and I have an anecdote of somebody who used LinkedIn to its best to contact as many investors as possible. You know, you could get one of these, you know, recruiter accounts, and you actually would do really well getting in contact with the right person. But getting an interest in somebody, in our case, it's really important. I would say, you know, like everybody here, there's a lot of inbound emails, and it's just so hard to spend enough time. It's literally almost impossible to give enough time to everybody that comes cold. So some entrepreneurs are very
you know, think outside the box. You know, just last week, I had somebody literally come up to our office and say, "Hi, I'm a founder. I need 5 minutes. Here's what I'm doing." Anyways, we had people send really strange gifts in order to get that point back. So anyways, it's interesting, but when somebody thinks outside of the box, obviously you pay almost a little more attention that is a cold email.
Robbery. No. No, obviously, get an introduction. We're all, you know, we've all been in the valley forever. If you can't find somebody that knows us, you're not looking.
Yeah, I mean, introduction is absolutely the right way. Don't start off your emails with, "You're stupid if you don't invest in this company." I had that happen multiple times at once. But, you know, part of like, you know, getting the introduction is actually a test of, like, what an entrepreneur you are. Okay? So, like, if an entrepreneur can't find a way to get an introduction to somebody he wants to meet, it's an indication of, like, okay, how's this person going to function? Like, you know, it's a tough environment, right? So beyond just getting in touch with me, like, the next round comes up, you know, how effective is this person going to be in raising that next round, right? So some of it is actually, you know, an indication of what kind of entrepreneur is reaching out to us. Having said that, we do respond to every email that comes in. Hello, GIC. But you know, it might be a cursory response, right? So you're not going to get a lot of feedback around, okay, you know, how can I make this better? Or what did you find wrong with it, or whatever? You'll get a cursory response, like, it's not in our scope. And if that's okay with you, then yeah, absolutely. You know, try that. Email us. But again, an introduction is the only way that we can sift through the kind of opportunities that we have.
I want to say a couple of things don't do. If you somehow do a LinkedIn email, please make sure that you can do a direct reply, so at least I don't have to actually go to LinkedIn to reply. That really annoyed the heck out of me. And you can guarantee you will not get a reply, because there's way too many emails. That's for one. And then if you're cold email, please do not ask for, "Hey, let's meet up, and then I will tell you more." I get a lot of those emails. I don't understand. I don't even know you. Why would I want to meet up with no information whatsoever? But it happens a lot. There are actually some cold email did work, because they were so clear bullet points. This is this, like, trash. Like, this is my install base, MAU, DAU, this is, you know, retention. It's just super clear. At least this is the length of install. This is my app, any, all these. And I'm like, oh, wow, interesting. At least you'll get me to, you know, play with it. So the way that you express yourself via email is also sort of showing what kind of entrepreneur you are and how clear you are with communication.
And do some research on the people you're contacting.
Yes.
You know, I mean, we're all sitting here. It's not our first rodeo. So if you look on YouTube, you can find his speeches. You can find my speeches. You can find a lot of that stuff. And this email comes in saying, you know, following up on your comments related to X, well, then that might be a dialogue we're willing to have.
I want to tell one funny story. There's a YouTube video. Jack Smith, the founder of Bungle, he got into AngelPad Accelerator by targeting the director, and, you know, using, I can't believe it was LinkedIn ads, and it was his picture, and it was like, they were targeting not only him, but his friends, and it would say, like, "Please tell Tom to contact this company." The guy was so interested that, I mean, it was like people, he said he woke up and he had all these emails from his friends. That's how they got the accelerator. So if you don't know anybody, you know, I guess think outside the box.
Because, you know, people Google their own name. So, yeah. Brendan Kim.
Very funny.
So that is announcements for the next phase. Trivia. MobileMonday 2015 trivia. All right. Top five answers on the board. Let's see. So this is kind of a trivia round on true or false. All right. So true or false, iOS continues to dominate U.S. smartphone market.
True or false?
True? How many people say true? False? How many of the false? And it is false. Android currently leads in the U.S. market 67%, and iOS around 28%. And this is based off of eMarketer survey or research data from 2015. Next question. What percentage of time spent on the internet is mobile with a mobile device? 2015. What percentage? This would be like, it's actually a real number in percentage versus a desktop or any other device.
Where are you necessarily in the world?
70%. 85.
You guys are living in a bubble.
85.
It's 51%, which is interesting. So mobile is leading mobile internet engagement in the U.S. How sad. All right. So what is the increase in percentage from time spent in mobile apps in 2013? So in terms of time spent, what was that increase?
20%.
It's actually almost doubled. 90%. So apps are actually interesting, but apps are actually eating up the internet. Okay, snake people. What percentage of snake people, because they're 18 to 34 year olds, never separate themselves from their devices?
Oh, 99%.
Including the bathroom.
97%.
Very close. And please use some disinfectant.
I always disinfect my phone, and I never.
All right. One time I tried to bribe my niece. Like, I'll give you $5 if you lick the iPad at the Apple Store.
The one in San Francisco, don't ever shop there. People get sick all the time. I always go to
the wearables are used today in the U.S.
Are being used or sold?
So the survey was asking how the demographic of folks that they were using wearables.
31.
So it's a number, and I would say sold.
Sold.
Sold is. And in terms of how many of the numbers, is it 10 million?
Oh, it's 30 million.
40 million. 30. Brendan has done his homework. 5 million, and it's a jump, 50% jump since 2014. So that means there are sock drawers, 50% more sock drawers have wearables. What percentage of installed apps are never used? Some people know this.
90%.
Yeah.
70. Is it more than 50%?
Yes.
Yes.
Is it more?
Yes.
Actually, survey says 1 in 4. So my phone was. No. So I don't know. Yeah, I guess.
Oh, okay.
I mean, everyone. All right. What is the average number of apps a user has installed in their smartphone?
50.
Average number.
50.
I got it. Okay.
I just use 5, right? So.
But installed.
Right. Okay. So more than 20?
Yeah. Yes.
40. Yeah.
More than 30?
Yeah.
More than 20.
Higher. All right. It is.
I know my phone is full.
Wow.
It cries.
Okay, advertisers, you're not doing your job. So it should be definitely more than that. All right. So how do users discover apps? And so let's step out.
Word of mouth.
Yeah. Is it? Yes. Word of mouth?
Facebook.
App stores? Okay.
YouTube.
Search, right?
Invite?
TV?
No.
No, not TV. How about ads? How many people have clicked on an ad this week? No, on purpose. On purpose.
And it
see how disruptive of how messed up our industry is for advertising? No, none of you have clicked on an ad, right? Yeah, really, some of you? But at least in the last week, have you guys put on an ad?
No,
on purpose. Accidentally, let's see how many people. 25% of you. Yeah, 46.
That is competitor.
Yeah, so.
Competitor.
Oh, yeah. All right, so this is what the survey came up with.
Yeah, friends and family.
50% by friends and family, 40% browse the App Store. Search engines, company was NTV. So there is room for TV in our lives.
Yeah,
so that must be the middle of the country.
Hulu.
All right. So that, everybody, thank you. Yeah, that's the. I got
to go.
So the final questions of the night are going to be predictions. And Mark, I'll get to you last because we got your slides. But. Get the microphone to Edith. What is going to happen in 2016?
I actually just, from last week's presentation, I have a whole, literally, if you Google my name, Edith, I have a whole deck about prediction. But there's a couple other things I didn't mention tonight I thought would be interesting and I'd like to see happen. One is, historically, there's a lot of startup ideas sort of copied from here to Asia. I think we'll start seeing a little bit of reverse, seeing certain business model that the US should copy. Just because there's like billions of people using it. There's a lot of very creative things that I've been seeing that I would actually like to see it happen here. And then a couple other things I found also fairly interesting is the rise of blockchain. I think there's a lot more sort of the fundamental, Bitcoin uses that. But Bitcoin is still very
right?
Yeah, on the encryption part. Cryptocurrencies, like policy wise, still very, very difficult. I'm starting to see like insurance starting to use blockchain and other creative ways to use blockchain. It's interesting. But I am not an expert, so I could go to my sort of the Bitcoin, the fintech expert to look at that. Travel tech, I think, is interesting, and also education.
The biggest thing for me, I think, is just in terms of a UX and the way we interact with our devices, whether that's phones, TVs, appliances, whatever have you. It was interesting to see the slide around the usage of apps increasing 90%. Was it since 2013?
Yeah.
I think it's a broken user experience. I think it used to be about, on the web, it was one site you went to, right? You went to Google. And that's where you started everything. On apps, it was very different. Now you were doing lots of siloed kind of interactions. But I think now we have so many silos that it's really kind of a broken experience. To do anything, it requires too many touches of the phone on the screen to go from one thing to another. It is a, it's a tedious kind of experience. So I think that things like what WeChat is doing in China, other messaging services around the world, I think that's an interesting take on that. I think what Amazon is doing with Echo is really interesting. So what can voice do, right? And I think other attempts at that, Spotlight is a really early attempt at doing something like that, but trying to change the way we interact with our devices, I think it's going to be really important over the next year. And I would say 2016 is a year where we're certainly going to be looking for technologies, applications, experiences that really try to challenge the current ecosystem of apps.
Yeah, I have to agree with Brandon on that. We've done a bunch of investments over the last 18 months on change, and I mentioned it earlier, how do you interact, what's the new interface for interacting with your phone, communicating with the apps, done a lot of AI investments and natural language processing, all sorts of interfacing, and I think that's going to be very exciting. I think we're at the end of the cycle of the traditional app, and a new cycle is almost beginning, so it's a great time to start a company that takes advantage of that. So I think it's inevitable that this is going to happen. We're going to fix how apps communicate, how we're more efficient, etc. And there's some amazing companies out there. I have a bold prediction. which is that I think we're going to have the first Hyperloop ride test in 2016.
Really?
It's true.
I think high-speed rail is going to be Hyperloop.
I think maybe Google will buy it.
Awesome. So I ended up for another thing putting together a few predictions, and I threw them on slides. So you know, over prepare, under deliver.
Well done, Mark.
So they asked us to talk about what's the future.
In the year 2000.
Go ahead. So this is the what's the future talk. But I didn't make that up. Tim O'Reilly does a great job of talking about what's the future. His WTF talk are worth watching.
All right.
And I steal them. So 10 predictions, okay? Number 10, counting down. If you watch the Faraday Future announcements,
see, yes.
It was abominable. And my prediction is you will never hear about that car again. Yeah.
Ironically, it will probably be the most successful e-vehicle in
the world. Some predictions are wrong. The electrification side, batteries are making 8, 9, 10% improvement every year. They're getting better and better. I think we're going to see some discontinuities in that actually take it a step higher. I'm seeing really credible entrepreneurs coming in with plans for electric airplanes with Tesla range. 150 total.
Do batteries follow Moore's law, though?
No.
They follow no one. They follow material science, but. So Uber, I made a couple comments about Uber. Uber and Lyft, that group today in San Francisco, which is the most mature city, do about 1% of the rides, which is actually a pretty big number. 1% of every car is an Uber car moving around. But their goal, obviously, is to get to 20 or 30%. And they're going to make that kind of progress. And that's when you really think about what's it like to be a car dealer or a taxi driver or whatever else, because that's going to really change things. Number 7, online shopping. Today, this year, it's 5% away from bricks and mortar. It's going to grow to 20% over the next few years. And that becomes the whole delivery economy. But that means that delivery becomes the battle for competition, right? We've gone from two-day delivery, one-day delivery, half-day delivery, next-hour delivery. I don't know how Amazon does it, but you know, I can get something literally out of the warehouse in 30 minutes. I don't know how they do it.
So does that mean I get to ride Uber for free if there's some Amazon in the trunk?
Something like that. So you know, if you're UPS or FedEx, I expect you'll be acquired in the next year, because owning you will be strategic. So if there's any bankers in the room, you should go make that deal. Whatever the finder's fee for that deal is pretty good. And the post office vehicles go 25 miles a day, and they bought gasoline rather than hybrid or electric. This is idiotic.
But that's government.
That's government.
Number 6. Seriously. We talk a lot, autonomous cars raise all kinds of security questions. Congress wants to have hearings to talk about security for autonomous cars. And they're all worried about hackers getting in and changing the volume on your radio. That is not the issue, guys. The issue is, if you can send a car anywhere you want, without putting a driver in it, then you can send a bomb or an explosive anywhere you want, without recruiting a suicide bomber. This is an issue. You can do all the software filtering to look for bad actors, and if the cars are driving around by themselves, that gets scary.
Thank you for broadening our paranoia.
That's what we're talking about.
I don't know if you follow the DMV regs, and that's pretty boring, but the autonomous car regulation in the last couple of weeks. The state of California came out and said, only you have to get a special license to drive an autonomous car. This is like a motorcycle license. You have to get a special education and special training in order to drive an autonomous car. And then the autonomous car has to have steering wheels, it has to have pedals, it has to have all kinds of stuff so that the driver can drive it. And if the whole point of autonomous cars is to get mobility services for seniors and impaired, then they're just blowing us up. So hopefully, there's hearings actually on Thursday. Hopefully we'll shoot that down. And otherwise, autonomous car development will move to Texas and Reno and leave California.
We are organizing protester buses
to go to Sacramento. NASCAR will have robot drivers competing against real drivers. Actually, in but actually, the cool thing is there are electric car races already. Right? The EVE, Formula E, it's called, and it's cool. There's 10 teams, Qualcomm sponsors one, and all that kind of stuff. And it's a pretty big deal, but they've just decided for this year, they're going to have a race before the main race, or the pre-race, the warm-up race, is going to be autonomous cars. Autonomous electric cars. So it's going to happen.
And a Formula One race car driver just joined Formula E.
That's right. That's right. And I mean, some of this is actually the easy part. Driving on a racetrack is by far the easier job than driving on New York City streets. The next president, not Hillary or Trump, the next one will have an electric limo. A multimodal transport, everybody wants to be able to buy a ticket, have that get you an Uber, a bus, a train, and anything else. Tesla's going to take it to the next step, and Elon's going to say you buy one ticket, takes you all the way to Mars.
So,
in the year 2000.
16.
So, since autonomous cars free up so much time consume booze and media, driving around will be free, but it'll all be sponsored by the media and booze.
So there's some nice little joke.
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone, for this is a wrap-up.
You can't read that? Sorry.
It's because
at the bottom it says, does your car have any idea why my car pulled it over?
So a round of applause for Harpal. Samsung and IBM for tonight. Panelists will probably hang out for a little bit, answer questions, and there's probably more, definitely not more drinks. Take us off yourself, and we will be kicked out at 9. Thank you.